Welcome back, everybody. In this video, I go over a couple of projects that I'm planning on doing, as promised in my Facebook Live video. Here's a knife that we're making today. Basic knife. Very, very few tools. I'll go over two more knives that I'm talking about. I actually added a few photos of some knives that I have made so that you can have a little faith that I know a little bit about what I'm talking about. Enjoy. Please hit like and subscribe, share with all your friends. I need to make $10 billion off of YouTube. If not, yeah, that's fine too. Anyway, Mike Rolly here, Ugly Pug Forge, Forge and Fire Champion, high school English, Spanish, and history teacher in Enterprise, Oregon, home of the Outlaws, junior high basketball coach. Hey, there's my pipe tomahawks I won Forge and Fire with. Season 5, episode 38. Check it out. There's another tomahawk. Anyway, hang in there till the end. This is a little bit longer video. Hope you enjoy. Again, thank you for being here. So what I'm going to do, I thought, you know what? What is the most basic knife? I mean, what can I do? How can I make a knife using the least of the fewest amount of tools possible? All hand tools. So I'm going to do that today. I'm going to make this knife. I'm going to use two files, a hammer, some tongs, my forge, and a big old piece of metal. That's it. Mine just happens to be an anvil, but do it off of anything. Okay, that's going to be knife number one. That's going to be very basic. Number one. Two is going to be a stock removal knife using some of the more basic tools that I have here. But I'm going to throw some power tools in, including a handheld drill and an angle grinder. And I recommend that those are the first two things that you buy as far as power tools. Okay? Angle grinder, you will use it every single day, forever and ever, until you get a way more elaborate setup. Okay? So the second one I'll make with an angle grinder, drill, and then hammer tongs. I'll actually forge it out. Okay, the last one I'll make out of this file, or one of these three, but this one, is I'll just do stock removal. Okay, we're not going to heat treat this. We don't need a forge, but we are going to need some power tools. There's no way that you're going to actually use a file to cut this, to file this, another file that's hardened. Just not going to happen. Okay. So anyway, look forward to that.
All right, I apologize for cutting off so abruptly throughout the video. I had visitors. You'll notice this is filmed over about three different days, three different time periods, because of that, because I got a visitor. And it's fine. I love having visitors. You can see my sword forge laying in the down on the ground there. I need to reline that. I'm using a propane forge that was made by Nathan Thompson in my Blue Mountain Blacksmith Guild. He's a good guy, got a nice little burner, very efficient forge. It's kind of running rough just because of the wind. It's a little bit breezy. All right, what I'm doing here is I initially started out trying to make a Scandinavian, say a Puko knife, which is a hidden tang knife that has Scandi grind. It's kind of a shorter blade, not very big, but very, very utilitarian. I'm trying to make a knife that is very basic, that you could literally burn in the tang, in this hidden tang. So what I'm doing here is I'm setting down the shoulders. I want the blade piece to be right down the middle as I'm forging away. All I'm doing is just kind of narrowing that steel, which is lengthening the tang of it. And the tang is just the hidden part where the handle, that would go inside the handle or in between two slabs. Now, I talked about not forging while it's dark, okay, when the steel is dark, not dark outside, excuse me, but you don't want to forge this stuff when it's cold. Now, we are in pretty direct sunlight here, and you'll see a little bit later during the, it'll be immediately during the daytime. So it's really hard to see the colors. Now, just because I've done this about 10 billion times, I know the colors back here. I'm watching the colors inside the forge, And so they are much brighter than what you're seeing on the camera. If that was in shade right now, that whole thing would still be a pretty bright orange. Okay, it's still pretty hot, but you notice it after a bit. Even now, all I'm doing is not really hammering to thickness. I'm not really wailing on it. I'm actually just tapping things back into place. Okay, this is the next day. I've gone ahead and continued drawing out the tang. Now, I made a decision here. The decision was that I'm going to make a blacksmith knife. I'm going to make a knife that a sharp knife, a Viking knife, some people call it. And what this is just all one piece. This tang, then, I'll lengthen it. And all I did is I just came up a little bit. And to save you the agony of just watching me hammer away on this thing, I just pushed the shoulder up to one side instead of in the middle. And you'll see that here momentarily. Again, I'm not really hammering it after dark. There you go. Now, I've drawn that out, which just means I've used the cross peen. I've hammered it flat, and then hammered it thin, hammered it flat, hammered it thin, and that just draws it out and makes it longer. What I did there is I showed that I needed about 2 widths in my hand. Most knife handles are 4.5 inches, but this one, because it has a bend in it, and because I want to continue it on a little bit longer, then I'm going to go ahead and hammer up a little bit. And all I'm showing here is that, again, that same hammer technique, and I'm coming up and developing more of a shoulder. All that's doing is giving me a little bit longer piece. I don't know if you can see that right there, but it is still pretty red, and the shoulder's up a little bit narrower. Now, all I'm doing here, I'm not hammering it really. I'm just kind of barely tapping it straight, and it is still has some color in it. I'm not really worried. The only time I've had some problems with that is with leaf spring. If you hammer it too cold at all, I've gotten some stress fractures in it. Again, get it back up to heat. Now, what I'm doing is I'm hammering in the bevels. And on the next one, I'll try to show, move the camera around for a little bit better camera angle. What I'm doing is I'm barely lifting the spine off of the anvil. The spine is just the back of the blade. And I'm hammering in and thinning out the actual cutting edge of the knife. Now, you can see a million videos on YouTube for that. I've hammered in the point, the tip of the knife. I cut out a lot of video. I had, I think, an hour and some actually ready to load on YouTube, and I thought, man, nobody's going to watch that. So what I'm doing here is I'm just working on the opposite side. Whatever you do on one side of the knife, you want to mimic or do on the other side. Again, I'm just lifting that spine up about 1/8 of an inch, maybe not even quite that much. And then I'm hammering in the bevels. Now, the bevels are just the flat part that leads from the back of the knife to your cutting edge. So as I'm hammering that in, it's pushing steel up and it's kind of bananaing and getting out of shape. So I just take a second, tap it back down, tap it back into shape. You can hear a gentleman, a guy in the background here visiting with me. He stopped by and I was not going to stop filming for love or money. Because I get all anxious. Yes, I do sometimes drop the piece. Okay, get a hold of it again with the flat jaw tongs. I use flat jaw tongs for almost everything. I would use those way more often than anything else. All I'm doing here is I'm just fine tuning. If I see a part that's a little bit fatter on the bevel, I go ahead and hammer the bevel. I go ahead and round off the edges of the back of the knife right here and just look at it. And you can see as I'm looking down it, things are not flat. I want to keep that knife, especially at this point, I want to keep that blade as flat as possible. If I can do that and keep the cutting edge right down the middle, this thing will be a cutter. And that's what we're looking at. Now, as I'm looking down here, all I'm doing is I'm looking at the blade. I extend it out as far as I can. I'm looking at the back of the blade, and then I'm looking at the cutting edge. And this is the next day. I didn't film actually wrapping this. All I did was take and set that down on the horn of the anvil. That's the funky little piece off the front there. And just twisted it around. Okay, I just hammered it around. And what I'm doing here is I'm just trying to fine tune a little bit and make sure that that's in line and tapped into place. I want a piece in the back end there where I put my pinky finger, and it's a little bit wider so I can get a hold of it. And then the front piece there, that is basically is a guard. Okay, protects my finger from riding up onto the blade. I can do anything with this knife. Is it fancy? No. Okay, I could have done some twists and making it all funky, but this is a fully functional blade. Literally, I could cut. All right, what I'm showing here, what I meant to say is I can cut my cheesecake, open my packages, stab somebody, still hand it down to my grandkids. Okay, now what I'm doing here is I'm just showing you push strokes. You want to push and not pull the knife backwards along that. Now, first I started pushing the stroke, which cleans it up, and then I showed a little bit of a pull stroke. Now, the pull stroke just flattens that knife, flattens those edges, those bevels, and what that does, it'll leave a few marks. What I'm showing you here is the marks are running the length of the blade, so then you want to come back and do a little push stroke on that to clean that up. But the pull stroke just makes everything super flat, which is exactly what you want. Okay, now the file being flat, thank goodness. All I do is I take, an 80-some cent piece of sandpaper, wrap it around there. I would start at 220. It just happens to be 400 that I have on the bench there, so I'm just showing you. And I just wrap that around there and do that same pull stroke, just back and forth, clean those up. I can come out with the same exact finished product with enough time as something that I do on my bench grinder, on my 2x72. It just takes longer. I can hand sand those bevels completely flat, and that will make it a cutter. I mean, literally, I love the flat edge. I love the completely flat grind. It is, to me, it's a perfect compromise with cutting edge, function and strength and all of that good stuff. There's nothing to hold it back. And, thank goodness I haven't sharpened that yet. But I left that within about a 16th before heat treat. Now, you want it no thinner than about a dime or so before heat treat. And I'll come back and I'll do some more hand sanding on this after heat treat, because you're going to leave some scale on it. All right, I'll turn you back over to the actual talking part. I'll turn you back over to the chatting head there with the Outlaw logo and the football t-shirt on. And no, I won't. I'm kidding. Okay, here I am heat treating. I forgot all about this part. Oh my gosh, I'm losing my ever-loving mind as usual. Okay, on the heat treat, what I do is I thermal cycle 3 times, which means now I've hammered this steel and I moved it around and I moved the molecules around and gotten them all excited by getting them up to temperature and then cooling them down. So I'm just running back and forth into the forge. Now I'm checking for it to get up to critical temperature. Now critical temperature is non-magnetic plus just a few degrees, okay, 10, 15 degrees or so. So what I'm doing is I am literally checking with a magnet whether it's non-magnetic. What I showed you there is the tip was non-magnetic, but the back was still grabbing. Put it back in the forge, bring it up to temperature, and it's really poor representation here because of the light. Now, pull it out, check for straightness, and I know that's my quench tank. It's about 10 miles long. But I know this is hardened because of, you can see the Martin sight there, the gray part where it just popped that steel off. Pop the oil off. Okay, here I am back. Turn you back over to
here's the blade.
Talking head.
Both sides there, you can see. Now you see that little kind of tan color? What that is after I quenched, one of the steps I didn't show you is I just stuck it in the oven twice for 1 hour at 400 degrees. Now what that does is, okay, if I take this file, where'd my file go? Right over here. So if I take this file that's fully hardened and I put it in a vise right now, I can just snap it, I can just break it. Okay, because it's super hard. Now steel will get that way, but it gets brittle. The harder it is, the more brittle it gets. So what you do, you take and quench this. Now this quenched, and it's at a certain Rockwell hardness, which means it'll hold an edge really well once you get the edge on it. The problem is it's not very tough, which means if you drop it, you know, you're working on something bone and you kind of tweak it like that, then it'll break here at the tip. So what you do is you put it in the oven 400. It eases a little bit of that brittleness, that hardness out, but it still will hold an edge, but then it'll be a little bit more flexible. So it gives it toughness. So you want, a good knife has a combination of toughness and hardness. Okay, you can use oil, you can use water. I was gonna use water because I said you didn't have to have anything special. You don't. I think sandpaper's a couple bucks or something like that, or a dollar or something at your hardware store, local hardware store. Okay, so all I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna go lengthwise on this and just do a little sanding here. Okay, now you see the oil and that black in there, those are just steel particles. Now really what that is more than likely is some of the steel particles you can see there, okay, where that's kind of shining up a little bit. Some of the steel particles, and then some of the slag that's left from forging, some of the oil from the quench, you get it hot enough so some of that oil sticks up on there, okay? What I'm gonna do is work that just a little bit. Now because I got this edge so fine-ish, okay, to begin with before the quench, here's the deal, you don't wanna get it too thin or it'll warp, right? You'll have this like going through there and it's hard to straighten. Believe me, I know about warps. You'll see at some point in your future here. Anyway, okay, so I'm not gonna do a lot of cleanup on this. This is gonna end up a sharp knife. You can take it all the way to a hand sanded finish. That'll kind of let you know where I got to on some of that. Okay, clean some of that off. Now this is high carbon steel. It's gonna rust. Okay, you're not going to keep it from rusting. But this part that was quenched in oil actually is tougher than the steel, on the surface anyway, not the oily part, but it'll help prevent it from rusting. It'll be kind of like an old-timer pocket knife. It'll get that nice kind of brownish patina on it, almost like you were doing a old long hunter weapon. Okay, so we have no edge on there. It's just kind of barely thin enough for that. So I'm gonna come, here's my flat. I don't know if you can see that. This is flat that I've filed on there. So I'm just gonna raise that up a bit. Now some people talk about angles. You know, this is sharpened at a 27.2 degree angle there, so it should be able to, you know, shave my back here like a champ. Okay, yeah, who cares, okay? As long as the angles are the same and as long as they meet in the middle, pretty good. Okay, if I want a like chopper, I'm like, I'm cutting some harder stuff, then I'll have a steeper angle. I might have to sharpen it more. Okay, if I'm slicing and I want really fine cuts, I'm gonna have like a steeper angle like this, a less steep angle for the other stuff. Okay, and if I have a really hard chopper like a kukri, I'm gonna do an apple seed kind of sharpen like that. Okay, for this one, it's a flat-ish grind, so I'm gonna come up about yay much. Do I know what degree it is? No. Do I care? No. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm just gonna come across here a few thousand times. Now this is where my belt sander that's right beside the camera here, you can't see it, but it's right there, is really tempting me, but yeah, I'm not gonna do that, okay? So once we get a few hundred strokes in that way, I check that. Okay, now I've got the edge removed a little bit there. No curl, still way too thick. So I'm just gonna switch it up, put a little bit more oil on there, water. Water with soap in it, dish soap. Okay, same angle, just on the other side. How do I know? Because I've done that for this same angle for long time. Okay. Now I'm sharpening this. Notice I haven't touched the tip very much though. Because right there, right here and here, that little bit is pretty thin already. Okay. It's thicker down here. So I'm taking, putting a little more pressure here, spend a little more time. Now when I get closer, I'll come here. Right, all the way through. I don't know if you can see that. Same angle. Okay, now I'm going to go back here in this angle. Just like a sharpening stone. Okay, same results as a sharpening stone, same result with my belt grinder, the whole bit. It's just going to take me a couple years. Okay. So I'm sure that you people, well, you people. What do you mean, you people? My wife hates that, so I keep saying it all the time. Don't tell her I said that. Holy cow. I got lines under my eyes. I need some preparation H under my eyes. Get that sagging out of there. Okay. So anyway, come across here like so. A few thousand times. Now if I had a really, really aggressive sharpening stone or an axe sharpener or something like that, I would use that. Okay, so we're getting closer, but you know, I'll probably have another 20 minutes or so. So to save you the agony of that, I'll come back when we're a little bit closer.
All right, came back when we're way closer. Knife is finished here. I've hand sanded as far as I'm going to on this blade. It will shave your arms. Here it is stuck into a log, just a couple picks of the finished product. Thank you again for watching. I know the editing needs a little improvement, but we're working on it. Here's some samples of a few other blades that I've done in the past in this same style, some with twists, some with little curly cues here and there. Still, the one that I forged for this video is still my favorite, most functional of all. Thanks again. Hit like, hit subscribe. Please share the heck out of this. I need about 10 billion viewers. Thank you.